Hello everyone, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the VIP programme for Collect 2021, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. Supported by Loewe and Cox London, I'm delighted to be broadcasting live the VIP programme from the new Crafts Council Gallery, which we hope will be open soon, but we just wanted to be here, and I'm surrounded by beautiful pieces of contemporary craft, and from this year's fair, as well as the stunning furniture that we've had loaned from Cox London. So what is the hottest contemporary craft to be investing in now? For this online version of the fair, we're running a series of special VIP events called Collect Selects, each focusing on different materials using contemporary craft. We can have Q&A at the end, and at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a little button and we'll be monitoring that for you. You will hear from expert voices who will take you through their favourites, giving you an insight into why the work is so exceptional. So we're now on Collect Selects number 3, Art, Jewellery and Precious Metalwork in association with the Goldsmiths Company. And so today we'll be discussing art, jewellery and precious metalwork, and the supporting partner, of course, for this is the Goldsmiths Company. We have two excellent contributors who will be sharing their favourite pieces of the fair, and they'll be joined by my wonderful colleague, Daniella Wells. So we have Katy Wickremesinghe, from founder of KTW Group. We have Stephen Webster, MBE, contemporary fine jewellery designer, and Daniella, who's market consultant for the fair. I'll let Katy introduce Stephen and Daniella, but KTW Group is a highly connected strategic communications consultancy in the areas of art market and the culture arena and luxury brand space. Katy herself holds a number of prominent advisory board and advisory and board roles, and serves on several important cultural patron groups. So Katy, tell us a little what you love about Collect and what you have discovered to share with us today.
Thank you so much, Isabel, for the very kind introduction. And hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. So as an arts and jewellery enthusiast and collector, I was excited to be asked to partake and help to host today's panel. It's such a shame not to be with you in Somerset House, where we should be trying on some of these beautiful pieces. In fact, I'm very lucky. I am. I have some incredible Stephen Webster pieces and some Christopher Thompson Royd as well, which we'll be talking about later on. So I'm hoping we can bring you the experience just as well virtually today. Please bear in mind that everything we're showing you is going to be live throughout the fair, so you'll be able to personally buy it, create one-to-one virtual appointments with anything that you are interested in. So I'm really pleased to be joined as well by a man who really needs no introduction at all, the legendary Mr. Stephen Webster, MBE. So Stephen is a renowned British jeweller known across the world for his fearless creativity, traditional craftsmanship and commitment to sustainable and ethical production. He's also a liveryman of the Goldsmiths Company. And alongside Stephen, we have Daniella Wells, a market expert and consultant from Collect since the fair began a long 17 years ago. So thank you both so much for joining. For those who are not as familiar with Collect, or it's your first time to the fair, I'm sure you may be aware that the fair was actually created by the Crafts Council, and it's committed to championing and raising the profile of contemporary craft to inspire all types of collectors, whether you are within or outside of the art world. It's fast become renowned as one of the key moments in the art world calendar. I think one of the things that I found most interesting speaking to Isabel and her team about this fair is the fact that over 80% of the works are actually made within the past 5 years, which means a lot of the pieces that you see and which we'll be talking about today, additions can be made especially for the fair as you're seeing them year on year. So as we zoom through, we're going to be picking some of our top picks. Steve and Daniella and myself have been super lucky that we've had a bit of a preview and been able to look through some of the pieces ahead of time. So we'll be talking to you about some of our favourites across the 32 international galleries, the 400 artists and the 35 nations taking part. So before we get into our picks, Daniella, it would be great to hear from you a little bit about the fair. Obviously, sort of jewellery, precious metals, one doesn't normally associate those with fairs as such. How have you seen the relationship between art and jewellery really coming together and fusing over the last, you know, couple of decades that you've been working with Collect?
Yeah, hi. So, well, I love to talk about jewellery, first of all, so very happy to come along. Since 2004, when we launched the fair at the V&A, jewellery and metalwork have been part of the fair in an essential way. We always wanted a mix of different disciplines, so they've always been a sort of critical factor. It's sort of near on 20 years worth of the fair that that I've been able to see some of the developments through time. In terms of the jewellery, we have we've got a couple of newer galleries coming up this year, which has been fantastic to see. A lot of galleries that joined us in the early days, very much based in European traditions, and we're seeing much more of a sort of encompassing of the world now, which feels like, well, this is contemporary work, as you said. You know, we're representing the world, and that's both, it's through all of the elements, but certainly the art, jewellery, and metal have been really interesting to see.
Fantastic. Well, we're looking forward to seeing some of those with your expert eyes, Daniella. And Stephen, you obviously have a craft background. You trained at Goldsmiths and you still incorporate a lot of that into your practice. What changes have you seen across the industry? And obviously with a move, everything going on with COVID, but, you know, it's just been a catalyst really to this move towards digital and new ways of seeing, new ways of being with jewellery. So can you talk to us a bit about your experience in that arena?
Yeah, I mean, from my very early time in this industry, I was fortunate to, during my sort of apprentice years in the mid-70s, work for what would be considered to be a sort of artist jeweller. And that was a very, very unusual thing to be and to work for someone like that. And there was sort of a peer group of Andrew Greimer, John Donald, you know, just a few, and very much sort of a niche. So I kind of understood the concept of something between a sort of more traditional approach and something that was more creatively designed and thought about. And I think that remains very much with me. And I've sort of, in my journey in jewellery, I've sort of seen that kind of category, if you like, shift from something that was very, very niche to now something that's, I mean, definitely not mainstream, but I just think the areas where you could, your opportunities in entering this industry can be from a much more creative sort of perspective, and not so much bogged down in some of the sort of traditions that were very much what you had to be part of in the fine jewellery world. And I think that's very refreshing. I think sort of galleries like Daniella's, which is sort of like an art jewellery superstore, shows that there's a demand for it. And I think, you know, constantly you see this evolving. So I find that the category is very exciting and very much part of what jewellery is today.
It's constantly evolving, as you said, into those arts and design sectors. So without much ado, let's go into some of our picks that we were fortunate enough to have a sneaky peek of earlier this week. So I wanted to start with Dorothea Pruhl. So really iconic jeweller, Marseille Gallery represented, who represents, and Danielle is going to talk a little bit more about Marseille. So talk to us a little bit about this piece. I mean, one of the things I loved about Dorothea's work is this mix between the materials and also lots of interplays on nature and design and the way she integrates the two. Stephen, what did you like about these pieces?
Well, I think it looks a bit like something that might have blown in from somewhere. It's got a lightness about it. I mean, it's hugely sculptural. You know, there's an informality about the structure, which I like, but it's still a piece of jewellery without question. You know, it's got elements in there that sort of tick the box of that, with the chain, obviously, that's connecting the shapes, the parts. And then also the finish, it's got a very interesting patina, which, you know, is a surface treatment, which adds to the story. I think it's a piece that you kind of want to look at, but also see it worn, which is, you know, it's a piece of jewellery. So
I think we have a picture, I think, if we scroll the screen, of the director of the Marseille Gallery. Daniella, do you want to talk to us a little bit about the gallery and its prominence sort of in the space?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, this is Marie-José van den Hoot, who is the director of Gallery Marseille in Nijmegen in the Netherlands. And the space there is, well, it's epic. It's a jewellery world. It's the largest jewellery gallery, commercial jewellery jewellery gallery even in the world. Dorothea Proulx is one of Marie Jose's most favourite artists. This is what she will be normally wearing on a day-to-day basis. She's very comfortable wearing a rather epic sized necklace, as you can imagine, in being in the business. The gallery Marzé is over 40 years old now. So really it's interesting hearing what Stephen was saying about the art jewellery movement and being part of that. And this has sort of really tracked that movement. And so Dorothea's work has sort of followed through the years. But a lot about the gallery, which is fascinating, is it's really pioneering new work. So probably, I think there's another image coming up now of the interior. A lot of people will know the gallery to do with the International Graduate Prize. So this is where Marie Jose supports fresh graduates from art school and the first year of
There's something
exposure.
Quite raw, isn't there? Something quite contemporary and raw about the space, which you wouldn't normally associate with high-end jewellery. And I think that experience piece, Stephen, how have you seen that, you know, in terms of the way that people want to interact with jewellery and the body and the way we wear it?
Well, absolutely. I think people love the conversation that's provoked by wearing jewellery. And that is, you know, obviously that conversation comes about by something that's probably fascinating to look at. People want to know what's behind it. And I think also the environment, you know, I look at this and think, okay, this doesn't in any way relate to what you call a traditional jewellery shop, which I also embrace.
Yeah.
Because it's a place that makes you want to know more about the environment as well. So, yeah.
I think it's worth, I mean, just closing up on Dorothea, I love the fact that she looks at the skeleton of the work. So there's this real feeling that it's actually the wearer that provides the depth and the breadth of what she's wearing. And I found a quote from her, which I loved, which is, "My jewellery is both a challenge to the wearer and an imposition." So there's a lot of provocation or meaning in self on Dorothea. So definitely one to look out for. I know that I've already been looking up a lot of her work and researched this talk. So if we can go to the next artist. So Christopher Thompson-Royd, I'm actually wearing Christopher, very lucky. And this is incredible pieces because both of these pieces, they actually come on a sort of sculptural stand. And I think what's fascinating about Christopher's work is this interplay between art, sculpture and nature. Stephen, what were your thoughts on Royd's pieces?
I love that there's a delicacy to it that I think is always a challenge when you're dealing with something like metal. I mean, we're looking at a gold here, but it could be any precious metal or indeed any kind of metal. It's not necessarily something that lends itself to a delicacy. And yet, you know, through the skills, the craft skills of the jeweler, of which one Christopher here demonstrates, you've got something that just feels like, you know, it's ultimately delicate. The scale, as you, I think you're wearing one of his brooches there, can be quite enormous, but it doesn't feel heavy. It feels really light. I love that he looks at moments in life, like we discussed before, the idea of a daisy chain and recreating that into a piece of jewellery. And there isn't anyone that can't think about what a daisy chain means and maybe takes you back to a moment, you know, a childhood or something. And all these are part of a storytelling that's so essential, I think, in jewellery.
And Daniella, what are your thoughts on Christopher's work?
Oh, well, like many people, I'm simply in love with it. And I'm not a big gold person at all. I actually kind of like some of the more bizarre.
You can never have too much gold, as I'm grieving today.
But this is where
adornment.
But this is the thing, and those pieces look great on you. I'm not really a precious metals person. You know, that's not what draws me in at all. But the fact that he's used gold for these sort of throwaway flowers, if you like, the sort of flowers you might pass and tread on, they've been preserved in gold, and it's that's really simple. And I mean, he's an artist. He is a jewellery ultra craftsman. I mean, these are all one of a kind pieces. They're not cast. They've been hand fabricated. You know, the craft skill is amazing, but it's akin to a limited palette for a painting, a simple pencil drawing that kind of just makes you feel emotional. And that's what I get from these works.
I think as a wearer as well, and a collector myself, I think that what's important about these is there's also that collectability around when you're not wearing the piece of jewellery, you have an art piece in your home or in your bedroom where you're actually keeping your jewellery. And I also love the fact that, you know, there's the difference, quite a, you know, different bandwidths in terms of the prices and the bracketing in terms, you know, this bracelet's around £500, whereas the earrings and the sculptures move into sort of just under 10,000. So let's move on to the next artist. We're able to travel far wider than we would obviously physically. We're now over in Thailand, and I'm going to let Stephen lead on this because it can't not be led by Mr. Stephen Webster, this one. So Tagichi Fumiki, Stephen, why is it that you loved this piece?
Well, okay, it's got a skull buried in there somewhere, which I think is maybe where you're referring to my probably appeal to my aesthetic. But beyond that, it's just a fascinating piece of metalwork. When I looked at it first, and I think when you looked at it first, it looks like something that's completely bejeweled. Mm. And then, you know, then our understanding became a bit greater of the way the artist works. And this is all achieved through silver and a surface treatment of silver, which is amazing to think of something that's, you know, not necessarily what you call blinging, which is silver, and he's made it bling. It's extraordinary. And that, again, goes to his skill as a craftsperson. And the depth that's in this piece is just phenomenal. I mean, you don't know where it starts and stops. And that sort of then adds to the thing I'll probably keep repeating here, you know, the intrigue, the storytelling, and the mastership of the craft that, you know, of being a jeweler.
And in terms of this sort of silver with radium, I think what's interesting as well is there's kind of a, it evokes kind of a crest or something quite traditional against something quite extreme. Daniella, I wonder if you could talk to us a little bit about Atta and Atta Space, because I know that they represent some fantastic talents as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're delighted to welcome Atta and Atta Art Space virtually. And in fact, we've got a photograph.
I think there's a photograph, exactly.
And a couple of we could go to the interior, but yeah, so they're brand new to us. Oh, thank you, slide management. So this is Atta and Atta Art Space in Bangkok, Thailand. So Atta have been specializing in wearables and art jewelry for about 10 years now, I believe. But they've expanded their space, and that to me means quite a lot, because it's really talking about the jewelry beyond wearables and really thinking about jewellery within the context of a fine art space, just the creative realm. So she's going into different materials, she's looking at objects, but it's interesting to me that sort of to start in jewellery and then go, you know, just go that step further. Mm. But the
and again, a very raw space, isn't it? I mean, there's something that's quite a juxtaposition between what's being shown and the space within which it's shown. It feels very accessible.
Yeah, absolutely. You sort of feel space. You feel you've got space to really sort of drill down and have a look at any one of these works. And that's a really important thing, I think, in terms of, you know, we're going to try and whiz through a few works from the fair here. But each individual piece, you know, be it a piece of jewellery, be it a piece of sculpture, has an individual story, an individual narrative, lots of complexity around the craft behind it. So, you know, I'm really pleased to see galleries like Atta looking at this sort of context, but the work is amazing in terms of the we were looking before at the skull brooch, and that's great. Actually, I looked at it on Artsy, just having a little browse as to kind of how the fair looks online. It stands. They've got great images. Actually, it stands slightly proud of the body. I mean, it's not for a shy moment. Certainly a brooch that you're going to take out and expect to be challenged on. And you know, you can see a lot of the sort of historical references in terms of the sort of innate references there in a super contemporary piece. And again, I mean, it's a one-off piece. I think that's another thing in terms of that's really key. I think every single work that we're looking at actually on your selection is a one of a kind, which is. It's important to note, I think.
And so let's move on to the next artist. Artist, jeweler, I mean, that's the other question, which will come to you later on. It's obviously such a blending line now between the two, which is increasing. So this is Japanese artist Mariko Kusumoto. I mean, I loved when I was looking through the pre-selection, this idea of very ephemeral beauty being worn as a kind of collectible piece. It's just, there's something very delicate and elegant about this. It almost sort of reminded me of the physical iteration of poetry. Stephen, what did you like about Kusumoto's work?
Well, I think the first thing I thought about was if this was available in the Elizabethan period, Queen Elizabeth I would have been wearing this. This looks like the kind of ruffle that she would have worn, and any royal with a good aesthetic. But and also it also strikes. I know it's a coral. It's named coral necklace, but it's soft, but it's got massive amount of structure to it, which is incredible to think of, and it also looked to me like a mineral specimen, which is whether people are familiar with the mineral specimen, as it comes out of the ground, actually there's definitely mineral specimens that this is how they grow. So I think I was looking at it from lots of different ways, but as a piece of jewelry, I guarantee it's comfortable to wear. So
definitely high level of wearability.
Very
high price point as well. So Daniella, do you want to talk to us a little bit about this specific piece?
Yeah, well, I was delighted.
It's from Macheco Gallery.
So Macheco Gallery, they're based in Germany, but they focus on Japanese artists and the Japanese aesthetic. So they have jewellery and they have other works as well. But I was really pleased you picked this out because this Japanese artist, I've seen quite different works. So this is, to me, what I know of her work is... it's much more, it was sort of coral based work and very sort of detailed. And this is a sort of super statement piece. So I phoned the gallery and said, well, what's specific about this piece? And so as you can see, it's made of polyester fabric. And apparently it's a one large strip of polyester that has been heated and folded, which takes forever, as you can imagine by hand. So this piece is actually very specifically in terms of her work, a very particular look, a very sort of particular way of sculpting this fabric. But actually, you may have quite expensive taste, Katy.
Might be a bit of a stretch.
But she has a number of pieces actually in sort of mid hundreds and sort of under 1,000. Because of sort of wanting to make pieces more accessible. But what's of course really important to remember is, so this piece is from 2020, very, very recent. These are artists living and working today, and they have a string of museum collections behind them.
Yep.
So even though some of these pieces are sort of, you might be able to buy and wear, they're being bought by museums. We take museum quality very seriously at Collect because it actually it means something.
And talking of museums, I'm going to move us on actually to the next artist. So precious metals. So Addy Topp, I think. Stephen, do you want to kick us off on Addy Topp and why we chose Addy's work?
Well, I think they're just so beautiful to look at, these bowls. And again, we've got two different finishes here. One that looks like a sort of a rose gold copper, with a sheen, which is beautiful. I mean, it looks soft and yet it's not. And then one with a fantastic patina, which could be copper, or I'm assuming could possibly be added to silver in a similar way. And there's perfection in these pieces, I think, that's very, very difficult to attain from the craft point of view. I'm familiar with the artist's work and no more pieces, but these pieces in question represent, I think, basically the aesthetic and the approach to the work. Yes, I would find a place for those in my home, definitely.
100%. I think there's also something that's quite unusual around the level of, obviously, it being metal, but the tactility and the fact you feel, it feels like you want to touch it and feel what the material is. There's a softness to it, despite the hard material. And I think it's worth noting that Addy Topp has actually become increasingly more recognised through prizes. So the Goldsmiths Craft and Design Prize, Loewe Craft Prize, Wallpaper Design Awards. So definitely one to keep an eye on. And Daniella, in terms of Alberston Fine Art, so do they specialise, do they cross over into other sectors, or how, what kind of artists do they work with and represent?
Yeah, so Alberston Fine Arts, based in the UK, they have quite a range of materials, actually, a broad range. They have clay, some textile in there, and have Addy's work, which is fantastic. The director of Alberston, is from an antiques background, there's a couple of exhibitors that have, you know, quite varying backgrounds as to kind of how they come to the fair and their selections. So it's fascinating to see what he's pulled together. But you know, we're talking about beauty here, something that people are just drawn to. You're both, mm-hmm. you know, responding to it exactly the way that Addy intends. She just created this new, well, she calls it a type of language in metal. And you say that very sort of subtle tactile aspect is really important. So the little rose gold whispering bowl, that's the one for the price, just to note there. This, she deals a lot with sound as well, in her broader practice. And this apparently has some little beads, moonstone beads in. So when you turn these pieces, they make different sounds. As I say, her broader practice has much more complicated work, but these are based on simplicity and subtlety.
I was going to say that they remind me of kind of sound baths and something meditative and quite spiritual about them which is amazing. So without further ado, I'm going to move on to the next slide because I want us to be able to get through everything. So Anna Davin, so something really fun and kitsch about these, completely different to Addy's work, obviously. So Stephen, what were your thoughts on these?
Well, they made me smile, which I'm sure is somewhere in there, an intention, which I personally find as a great plus quality, because, you know, often it's not necessary. Part of the language of a lot of craft is not about making people smile, but this does. And you've said it's quite kitsch. You actually told me before I knew that these were, that the cat and the dog are cut from tins of biscuits, which immediately made me feel that everybody loves a biscuit. So we're on to a winner there. And then the sort of combination is combined with something that, you know, we can recognize as precious jewelry. It's got these tiny little pearls, which are sort of so beautiful, used together as a sort of a pave, sort of en masse. And that, that creates a texture, part of the halo, and then gold. So it's a really interesting combination of something with sort of very little value, the biscuit tin, and then preciousness. And I think it's something that I really like, the shift, if you like, in certainly in the category of art jewellery, but also in more mainstream jewellery, where people feel that they can combine things that wouldn't necessarily have been, you know, looked upon as something that could have more value, you know, than the parts. And I think this is probably a good example of that. So, the wit and the combination of material I really like here.
I think, that idea as well of sort of lost and found, and the kind of soaring of the rough edging of the work. And I think, as you say, Stephen, I think both of us were really drawn to the fact that so often, I think we all agree that art fairs, or the idea of collecting, can feel quite intimidating and quite difficult to know where to start. So there's something that's almost a bit self-deprecating about these pieces that enable you to just engage with them on a really real and raw level. And this idea of taking something as simple as a biscuit tin or is low value, and I think putting it together with something very high value creates something just completely unique and different. So Daniella, I think we're back as well in Thailand and Asanasa, which seemed to embrace some really bold pieces. What are your thoughts in terms of Anna's work, and is this also characteristic of her wider body of work? Does she often interplay this look and feel of the animals and the different metals?
Yeah, so from what I know of Anna's work, an Australian artist based with, you say, the Thai gallery, Atta, that certainly the sort of comic aspect is super important in the sort of overall commentary. You've both noted something which is key here, which is the question over the value of materials. And that's something in the broader art jewellery debate, if you like, as a movement, is really questioning kind of why we find any particular material valuable. And that's something which is a recurring theme. I mean, these are absolutely fantastic and very, you know, this is the sort of thing that you would wear and it would cheer you up every second of the day. But yeah, humour is really important. As you say, it's great to have that as an art fair. When you go to the stands with jewellery on at Collect, there's a level of sort of contemplation around some of the stories on the piece and sort of looking through details. But there's a lot of laughing, you know, when people are trying on pieces, they're talking about works of art that are being part of their body and their personal space. So All of these funny little sort of awkwardness is something that art jewellers love to play with.
And I think wrapping up on Anna, let's move on to Gianpaolo Babetto. So this is actually an artist jeweller that was born in Italy, and I think he's now around 75 years old. And if you look at Babetto's wider practice, there's something incredibly architectural around the way that he puts his works together. So he's looking at process, he's looking at materials, he's looking at craft in the way that, you know, you can imagine this being, you know, a sculpture or an architectural object that you're actually having in your home and not even wearing. Stephen, talk to us a bit about your thoughts on this on this artist.
Well, he is definitely a godfather, I think, of art jewellery movement. And you've said, I mean, he's been around for a long time, a veteran, I think, for a reason. I look at this and if I look at it purely from the craft level, I mean, it's incredibly complicated piece. I think every piece is hinged, which means that even though this looks like it could be quite awkward, it's not going to be awkward. It's going to, the one cube's going to influence the way the next cube moves. And, you know, it's definitely a piece I want to pick up and hold. And I want to see how that movement is, because I'm imagining on a body, it sort of goes with shape. It's going to sit there. It's a necklace, so it's going to sit in there probably perfectly. I think it feels very luxurious as well. Part of the way he's coloured the insides, which could be a type of lacquer or enamel, with the red and the white, just adds to the luxury of the piece. A very, very sophisticated piece. And you know, this will be treasured forever. So
I think there's something, isn't there, in the angular nature of the cubes, along with the fluidity of the hinging, which is so beautiful to look at. I would really, it's one of those pieces where I wish we could literally pick it up out of the screen right now. And Daniella, talk to us a bit about Gallery Rosemary Jaeger in Germany.
Yeah, so I was lucky enough to look at this piece via Zoom just recently as part of our museum professionals Zoom tour with Rosemary Jaeger, a very established gallery in Germany representing this important Italian artist. And what was wonderful is she had this golden, say, the sort of pigmented sections. She had the piece, but all sort of bunched together like a little city. So these little geographic, these little sort of, you know, the geometry of those shapes, she'd aligned to make this sort of little world. And then she just very simply, and she's extremely sort of subtle and really a beautiful person to listen to, she just lifted up one end and it sort of tinkled, and you could feel through the sound the lightness. So exactly what Stephen was saying, you know, this is an epic piece of sculpture in its own right, but then you move it and you move it with the body and it'll look different on different bodies, and that's, you know, very much part of the piece. But I mean, my goodness, very difficult to make.
It's a very iconic one, obviously, to keep an eye on market-wise as well, with his history and relevance in terms of on the market. So moving on to Jonathan Boyd, we've got a couple more to go, and then I know we've got time for questions as well from the audience. So if anyone has any questions, do please submit them. So Jonathan, so unusually, we loved this piece of work, but I know we also loved the kind of raw and real and fresh way in which it's been presented. Obviously, it's a high value piece, but there's definitely something that makes it feel accessible. And I think a lot of that is in the, I kind of suppose, the grittiness in the way it's been put together. Stephen, talk to us a little bit about Jonathan's piece.
Well, I think Jonathan is a jeweler with a lot to say. I think there's, you know, even this image feels like there's, you can probably feel there's a connection to the earth, the planet, maybe sustainability. There's going to be a lot of messaging going on here, which is part of his sort of, the language of his jewellery. And with the links, they, from sort of where we are, all of us, it looks like something that's just kind of got texture. But a lot of his links, you know, they've got a real sort of like, I like that they look like they're hewn, you know, by the sort of a process. You can imagine this sort of process of making these links is quite, you know, hardcore in a way. But then when you study them, they're all language. They're written, there's dialogue written around every link, which of course then you try reading the what's written on there. So you're up there studying. Yeah, and I find that absolutely fascinating. I love it because of the fact that it can work as just a texture, but then when up close, you know, there's a lot more that's going on.
So, it's a very, very intelligent making, isn't it? I mean, Jonathan Boyd, when you say the words, you have to kind of go in and study it. So he's doing PhD supervision at Glasgow School of Arts. He's in various private collections at the Victoria and Albert, the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. So he really uses very sort of critically researched methods and uses quite an interdisciplinary approach, which I think is much more complex than it probably can look on the outside when you're approaching the work. Daniella, how does, you know, what's Jonathan Boyd's market like at the moment, and how does he fit into the art scene, would you say?
Well, I'm really pleased you chose this because, I mean, gosh, we could have an entire display on his work in terms of, you know, PowerPoint. It's very, very layered work. I believe he's been teaching and is the acting head of jewellery and metal at the Royal College of Art, a very important hub of thinking around jewellery. Stephen was talking about the narratives, the text within the piece. Yes, you know, there's a lot of social comment. There's a lot of political comment. There's sections of newspaper articles. You can decipher some pieces, some bits of the language, and others not. And I think it's very much sort of part of sort of almost like listening to a fragment of a conversation. I've seen an installation of his work. I mean, the wearability of this piece, it's interesting. Yeah, some people are going to wear it. It's very much about the environment that he's creating. He creates wall pieces where you lift off a piece of jewellery. I mean, it's very sort of classically art jewellery, if you like, in terms of the sort of people that are going to be interested in his work are those who are sort of enthusiasts for the movement, definitely. I mean, I certainly have pieces.
I mean, he literally is creating. He's creating the environment himself, isn't he? Through, he's sort of you know, I suppose, directing you to the environment in which he wants you to view his pieces, which is an, you know, incredibly intelligent way in which he's presenting and does present his work generally in a bigger environmental or contextual perspective piece, which I think is incredibly interesting as well. And I would say definitely one to watch out for as well. Gallery Marseille again. So moving on to a couple of our, we've got two more left. So Levan Jiskarian, I hope I'm saying that correctly, something so beautiful, so raw, so natural around this piece, which I initially thought was a bracelet, but was then told, no, it's actually a necklace. So quite a dramatic piece. What would you say about this piece, Stephen?
Well, I think my first impression was that it looked like something that you might find on a beach. And not just sort of a piece of driftwood, but something that had structure, like part of, you know, we call them groins, which are the wooden structures that run down the beach to stop erosion. This looks like a piece of a groin in that context. And even the sort of the nails, the way that they're kind of hammered in, but not perfectly on the inside, just add to that. It's a really beautiful object. And like you, I thought it possibly was a bracelet, but now I understand it's not. I want to see it worn. it definitely will be an interesting visual. But one thing for sure, because of this sort of this eroded look to the wood, I'm sure it's very comfortable.
So, I think also going back to Dorothea Poole's pieces, this this element of mixing natural material and metal, I think is played upon as well. So the rawness and the softness and that hard material, I think is done beautifully here. And I think it's worth sort of saying as well, there's something that's quite, as Stephen, as you said, this natural landscape piece, it's as if it's the side of a clifftop sort of cut in half. And there's something quite aged about it, even though it's probably actually a very contemporary piece. And Daniella, what are your thoughts in terms of Levin's work?
Yeah, so Levin is a Georgian artist that Marzé has taken on. And this piece is part of her whole floor that she's devoted to celebrating Collect, but she's been with us since the very first year. And you've said it, this is the sort of reaction to have. I was looking via Zoom at her preview of her Collect kind of edit, and she popped it on. It does, it sits on your shoulders.
I mean, how big actually is it on the neck? Yeah. Is it very wide? Does it cover most of the neck, or is it quite small?
It sort of sits as a kind of collar. Yeah. So it's a proud collar.
Yeah.
So very much it's something that yes, I mean, he's already been
there's a very grand piece, but with very simple material, which is incredibly impactful, isn't it, when you wear it.
Yeah, absolutely. And it works as a sculpture in its own right, as an object. And, you know, there are people who be very comfortable to wear this sort of epic piece. He has already been purchased by important museums and collections because of sort of where he's stretching in the art jewellery realm. So, it's lovely, I think, when these pieces border on not wearable and really kind of make you wonder, how do you get involved? Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. So let's move on to our last artist. So Kim Kun-ju. So female artist exploring the ancient and decorative techniques with mother of pearl. I found these pieces just make you sort of stop in your tracks, just the level of simplicity in terms of the bowls, but also the intricacy that, again, I think there's that constant conversation in a lot of these pieces that we're picking out, where there's a duality of being in them. Stephen, you are an expert in craft yourself. You've obviously as part of the Goldsmiths group. So talk to us a bit about the level, because I can imagine this looks pretty painstaking to make. In terms of techniques and time.
Yes, I think in an earlier conversation we were having, you described these as like quiet pieces, and I get that completely, but then looking at it with my craft hat on, it feels like it's screaming. Both of them are screaming. There's so much going on to achieve this simplicity, because it's two tumblers, but you know, each one, painstakingly, this is a mosaic of mother of pearl. And I think, you know, this definitely feels like a piece that could only come from Asia. Meticulous. And then, you know, ultimately the simplicity of the silhouette. And it just reminds me of, I've been in Kyoto and watched the lacquer artist who will spend months and months on something that ultimately will just be a simple bowl. And this falls into that category. I love it. I love Mother of Pearl anyway, because it's got, you know, untold amounts of a rainbow of colour in it. So applied in this way onto what appears to be, excuse me, two silver tumblers is ultimate craft skill.
And Daniella, why did you choose this piece?
Yes, so I'm very pleased that we've been traveling around the world. So these pieces are currently in Jeju Island in South Korea with the gallery Lloyd Choi. She's done the most beautiful setup. And again, I was very privileged to be on a Zoom where the gallery director, the gallery directors are the experts, talking through the different works. I mean, these, as Stephen says, you can fit one in your hand comfortably. It's a super simple shape. It's mother of white pearl. It's actually on a nickel base. And apparently the the mother of pearl is hand cut and applied with, unsurprisingly, this lady is very interested in being very precise. She takes a lot of time on putting these works together.
And does she do it? Does she work on her own? Does she have a team? I mean, this level of work is obviously very time consuming. So do we have any idea on that?
As I understand it, it's entirely her work. Lloyd is always the specialist to go to for that, and it is very much about her kind of communicating with this piece, the artist, and layering and layering. She puts on the mother of pearl with otachil, so a type of kind of Korean lacquer. So a lot of, and like Stephen was saying, a lot of this is sort of ultra traditional craft. This is craft that's been essentially been a type of craftsmanship that's been around for a long time. But these are contemporary artists preserving some of those amazing traditions, but with a contemporary voice to them, and they just look exquisite in the space.
And I think
I hate to interrupt, but something that's really,
it's all right, we're used to it, it's fine.
The last two pieces, which is where the intrinsic value is irrelevant. One looked like it's made of wooden nails, and this piece nickel, which, so it's not even silver, and mother of pearl, which essentially is not a valuable commodity. And yet, everything about this, the value, the price tag is about the craft. And I think that's a really important thing to think about, and it does get thought about. It gets a chance to be the value in more art jewelry, which is a frustration, I think, in more traditional jewelry. You can't eliminate the intrinsic part. So what's the gold weight? What's the diamond weight? And here we're just looking at craft. That's it.
And I think, even going back to some of the earlier works we're looking at, so the polyester works, for example, you're looking, the value of a lot of these pieces, as we know, is in that craftsmanship, and it's in that the coming together of a kind of fearlessly creative route, which is that, we described yourself, Stephen, in terms of the practice and trying out new things and exploring new methods, but also putting it together with time-honored techniques. And this idea, I think, which Colette brings together so well, which is why I know I'll be jumping online this week for sure, having another hunt down for things, is this idea of legacy and future coming together, which feels a really natural point for me to say thank you both so much for joining today and being part of the panel doing our whistle stop virtual tour. It's just a reminder as well to anyone that's watching, you are able to actually go and make virtual appointments and get in touch with the galleries throughout the fair. So please do explore these pieces and these artists further. And I'd like to invite back in, I think Isabel has got some questions for us from the audience as well. So we'll just spend a few minutes going through those.
Thank you, guys. That was
thank you for your time.
Fabulous, really interesting, and really great. So we've got a few questions. Some I can kind of combine actually because they are really interesting for people. I think again, Stephen, when we were on a call before, we're kind of talking about that kind of understanding of what an engagement ring is, or what a the kind of more sort of fine jewelry, and then that distinction to art jewelry. So it's sort of, what are the benefits of investing in art jewelry? And if you're a kind of beginner collector, how can you build that kind of confidence? Obviously we have our galleries, but it's just as you, a little bit about what you were just talking about, the value is actually in the craft and getting people to understand that actually they're very wearable and very enjoyable.
Is that a question to me? Sorry.
Yeah, why don't you go? You go.
Okay.
For it.
All right. So, I think, first of all, I think with anything, it doesn't matter if it's a art as a painting, or it's got to be something that appeals to you. I think the aesthetic of it, and that you're going to enjoy to wear. If we're talking about jewelry, I know we've had some objects as well. You've got to be proud to wear this piece and enjoy the fact that you are going to be questioned about it, not in an interrogative way, but just by the fact that you're wearing it has made a very, very different kind of statement to about what jewelry and an accessory can be. And then of course, if it's something for the home, it's the same. You want to live with it. And I love the fact that these things aren't about necessarily the material. I mean, the material is ultimately important to what the structure is, but the value of that material sort of goes out the door in a way, because we've seen here, I think the variety in just six or so pieces is endless. Biscuit, tin, wood, you know, nickel, mother of pearl, you name it, you can make something amazingly aesthetically beautiful out of it. And so I think that's how you probably should look at your, you know, your investment, obviously your budget, but just as the piece, you know.
Oh, that's great. Interesting. They're sort of done saying galleries are very upfront with their prices, and some say price on application, and kind of why is that? And it's just kind of an interesting conversation, and that kind of goes across, I think, a lot of art forms. Just interesting to hear what your experience is of why you think that is, and because sometimes it makes it sound like, oh, it's so expensive, we're not going to put it up. But it isn't always necessarily about that. I don't know who would like to answer that. Daniella, maybe you would like to answer that.
I answered on the behalf of galleries that are very varied. Galleries look after their artists, and price is something which is obviously really, really key. Often it's the artists themselves saying that they don't want the price to be put on the work. Now, I don't know whether that's a fundamental problem with, you know, looking commercial or putting a price on something, like as Stephen was saying, we're looking at, you know, an art form that is about ideas. It's not about the sort of how much it costs in weight. It's normally around the artist being a little bit more cautious about wanting to reveal their price. It can be for some works which sort of become difficult to value, because of the fact that they're, you know, these are always unique works, but the fact that the artist is unlikely to be making any more in this series or not, there could be a number of things. But with price, yes, and on Artsy, they say you should put your price on because people want to browse, they want to know whether it's in their budget. It really is the call of the gallery and the artist and what they decide together.
I think it's also a question of value, isn't it? And it's how we value what we want to invest in. And I think that changes through so many things. It changes through our experience of how we view the world, our age, our limitation, how much we can afford. And I think I know when I started collecting sort of in both disciplines, sort of across jewellery and on artworks, there's a real misconception that you can't ask about price. If it's not labelled, it's too expensive for you to even think about buying. And I think one thing I would encourage anyone watching to say is, do ask, do have the conversations, feel confident about a monetary conversation around creativity, because the more you can have those conversations, you find some incredible doors opening up. You know, one of the pieces we saw earlier, Christopher Thompson Royd, for example, one of the pieces is 500 and one is 7,000. I know I could afford one and not the other. Some people may afford neither right now. And I think that flexibility and this idea that there is sort of, there's not as much judgment as one might think with galleries. So do you feel that you can, you know, email and ask and explore? And the other thing is to kind of research those artists and feel confident about what their price and their market is as well. I think it's a really important way to start exploring that conversation.
No, that's really interesting. I mean, we as a fair always encourage the price, because and Artsy was backing this up for us, is if someone knows a price, there's much more likelihood of a sale. Because you kind of understand what you're looking at straight away. And if it's a price that seems quite high, then it makes you wants to be more inquisitive and understand why. And it kind of goes back to what Stephen, you were saying about understanding the craft and the making, and it kind of begins that dialogue so that people can understand more about it.
Completely.
I was just wondering, Katy, how easy might it be to move your brooch and show it closer to the camera? We've just got a few people.
I can,
because I think people just really gosh, that's lovely. Look at that,
it's detail. Beautiful. I was actually just going to show you, sorry, let me just show you the stands. So these actually come, this is the earring stand. I think what's amazing about these, when you take these earrings out, and there's the same stand for the brooch, and actually I was very fortunate to see these in action previously, because Christopher has done some work with the Saraband Foundation as well, who I've done work with in London. But when you put them in, they literally do look like an art piece. You would never be able to tell they're earrings. And what's quite unusual with both these pieces is there's a delicacy in the subject matter, in that they're floral and fauna, but when you're wearing them, the sort of design element is much more, there's something more impactful and much more strong than you would initially think at first glance. So I don't know if I'll be giving these back, I have to say, Isabel. I might keep them.
That's fantastic. And then we also had a question, Daniella. I know you're wearing a piece from House on Mars Gallery. Someone was asking about the piece you're wearing.
That's right. Oh, well, thank you so much for asking. This is Lena Peterson's work. And I thought it was very important to try and wear as big a necklace as I could for the Zoom. It never really has come up in life before to try and kind of communicate my necklace via my laptop. Normally, it's a much more tactile experience. This is a piece of wood. I love the colors. I've fallen in love with a brooch. Similar to Katie, there are some of these loaned items I find difficult to give back. House on Mars is a new gallery for us this year, which is fab. So we have Atta Gallery from Bangkok and House on Mars, which is a brand new gallery space. A lot of wearables, but also into lots of different materials, lots of plastics. And they've opened up in London. They opened last year. So as soon as the doors open, I think we should go and have a look at go and look at that gallery as soon as galleries are allowed to open again.
Very good. Very good. Well, thank you, all of you. It's been fascinating and really enjoyable and joyful. And you're going to just see me. I've been doing my little notes. Hang on. Go on, you can put me on. Sorry. Caught me at it. There we go. No, but it's just been really, really wonderful. And I'd like to thank the Goldsmiths Company again, who do so much support and have done for literally centuries. They're one of the oldest livery companies, and they have been supporting their own area with their students all the way through, and obviously work with wonderful people like Stephen. But I just want to say thank you to you, Katie, for chairing it so wonderfully and being so enthusiastic, and to Stephen for all your insight, and Daniella, obviously, my great colleague, who's so knowledgeable. So this will be recorded. It will be available afterwards. But thank you to all of you who've joined us today, and we enjoy the rest of the fair. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you.